people of Rotherham, Mexborough and Swinton, they were simply the trackless, workhouse donkeys serving the people in these heavily industrialised, densely populated coal and steel-making communities. There was also joint operation. The small green trackless belonging to the Mexborough and Swinton Traction Company. Whilst the blue six-wheelers belong to Rotherham Corporation. This is the story of the trackless, which existed from 1912 to 1965. They had started as feeders to parts of the one-time network of tramways, which had stretched from Sheffield to Barnsley, the last bit of which bowed out in 1960. This was the Sheffield route from Beechief to Vulcan Road, which incorporated the area's first horse tram line, as well as part of the path of the old jointly operated Sheffield-Rotherham service. Whilst the former kept faith with the tram, Rotherham opted for trolleybuses, converting most of its routes in the 1930s. The rebuilding of the bridge in the background had ended the old joint tram route in 1948. The original Rotherham fleet had included single and double deck cars, most of the latter being provided with protective top covers, as were new trams delivered from 1909. After the First World War, second-hand vehicles were acquired, a dozen single-deckers from Oldham and 10 XLCC B-type from London, the majority of which were later sold to Sheffield, where they joined identical cars purchased by Sheffield during the war. After the war, the corporation pursued a policy of buying new trams and modernising older vehicles. In the mid-20s, more old cars were upgraded, and a few glimpses of these will be seen later in the video. Rotherham was only the fourth operator in the country to run trackless trams, as this photographer called them. It also became the first municipality to run outside its boundaries when the route from Broome Road tram terminus to Maltby was opened in 1912. Six Milnes Voss-bodied 28-seaters were acquired, mounted on David Brown chassis to work the rural 4¾-mile run, where uneven road surfaces could cause problems. This Straker Clough was of historical significance. When delivered in 1922, it carried a front entrance row body. Later, the corporation rebuilt it with this centre entrance, a design favoured by their manager, T.P. Sykes. These row-bodied Straker Cloughs, delivered in the mid-20s, were also later rebuilt with centre entrances. When the Mexborough and Swinton Tramway Company, or MS, opened its 7-mile route from Old Toll Bar to the Rotherham boundary in 1907, its trams drew their power by means of the Dolter surface contact system. Based at Rawmarsh Depot, the company initially had 16 trams, 12 of which soon had protective top covers. Being extremely unreliable, the studs were swiftly abandoned. Wires were strung along the whole route, and joint services between company and corporation began in earnest. Four balcony cars were added in 1908. When the M&S applied for powers for trolleybus lines, only the two shown in turquoise were approved. Just as in Rotherham, both were tramway feeders. Opened in 1915 and operated from a new combined depot at Old Toll Bar, one served the colliery at Manvers Main, whilst the other ran from the depot to the Dale Conisborough. Owing to the presence of four low bridges, the company could never operate double-decker trolleybuses, so its first three vehicles were solid-tyred, brush-built 28-seaters, each costing £823. Note the primitive covering for the driver. In 1917, a similar vehicle was purchased from Stockport. Both during and after the First World War, trolleybus operation was at the best spasmodic. However, regular operation resumed in 1922 with a pair of AECs with Strachan and Brown bodies costing £1,560 each. A third followed in 1924, releasing the older vehicles for scrap. M&S hoped to expand its own tram network following opening of the Dern and District Light Railway in 1924. Connecting tracks were actually laid at Swinton, but saw very little use. In fact, the Dern and District lasted just 9 years. It had simply arrived too late and was bedeviled by old-fashioned track layouts. It rapidly fell victim to competing buses. Fortunately, a few of the cars did find new homes. The M&S too decided to replace its trams. After reaching agreement with Rotherham, the company's trackless would run into the town centre, whilst Rotherham had powers to operate to any of the company termini. The M&S trams disappeared in stages during 1928-9. Replacing them were 30 Garrett O's with 32-seater centre entrance bodies delivered between 1927 and 1930. Here, number 37 passes Doncaster number 1 at the old toll bar in March 1928. The 55-seater Garrett OS was filmed making a trial run along the length of the original 1915 route from Old Toll Bar to the Dale. The entire 2 miles had been rewired and repoled. Deep in the coalfield, at the troublesome Denby Main level crossing. Interestingly, Garrett's would only build trolleybuses for a few years, the last examples coming to Mexborough in 1930. The single-deckers were to prove an exceptionally good investment at just under £1,700 each. This was the only time a double-decker scaled the heights around Conisbrough Castle. Here it is seen at the original 1915 terminus. Very soon the trackless would be extended over brand new wiring to Conenby. Until the new Warren Vale Road opened in February 1932, the trolleybuses had to tackle this treacherous old road. For its small contribution to the joint service, Rotherham purchased 4 6-wheel guys with 32-seater row bodies. Shortly after the demise of the trams, the conductor watches the passage of the poles as number 45 turns from Rawmarsh High Street into Stocks Lane. Scenes in Park Gate, with the disused tram track still in situ. One of the 1929 guys passes slowly under the Midland Main Line on Rotherham Road. Note the abbreviation for Conisbrough. One of the original open-top trams rumbles into town. This had been fitted with a Leicester-type top cover. With its distinctive clock, Effingham Square was the hub of the Rotherham system. Vehicles arriving from Mexborough offloaded in Effingham Street. The highly respected Rotherham manager, T.P. Sykes, was a firm believer in the trolleybus. He also extended the centre entrance design to include the town's motorbus fleet. Turning into Howard Street to reach the pickup point in Frederick Street. the new and the old order at the loading point in Frederick Street. Edging up behind is tram number 22, one of the cars with a new saloon, but an old top cover and motors. The lines to Kimberworth, Dalton and Thriber all went trackless shortly after in 1931. All three forms of Rotherham Transport. Guy 46 of 1928 is on the 7 mile interurban run to the mining town of Maltby. Rotherham developed a fixation for renumbering. For example, 46 later became 45. In the background, one of the 1909 UEC four-window trams. To replace trams on the Kimberworth and Thriber routes, 22 craven-bodied Ransoms were acquired in 1921. Next was added at the Kimberworth end, and in the vicinity of Thriber, the trackless were rerouted to accommodate a new branch to Silverwood Colliery. Between 1931 and 1942, the joint routes terminated at the newly created All Saints Square. Four short extensions completed the M&S Traction Company network. The first were added in 1931. A branch along Addick Road in Mexborough, built with a view to further development that never materialised, and a loop at Park Gate. A spur along Kilnhurst Road, Rawmarsh, was added in December 1933, which was then incorporated in October 1934 into the Green Lane Loop, which served the growing Ryecroft area. Although the Canclow route went over to buses, Rotherham built trackless extensions to Broom Lane, Worry Goose Lane in 1935 and Greaseborough in 1936. The corporation had also wanted to replace the Templeborough route. However, when Sheffield refused, 11 single-ended cars were built by English Electric in 1936. As the network expanded, more trackless arrived. For example, in 1933, 10 two-axle Guy BT-32s were acquired, half having locally built Craven bodies and half by Roberts of Wakefield. 1933, Guy's again with Craven bodies. In 1937 came 14 more Cravens. This one is on an AEC 664T chassis. Then in 1939, Rotherham switched to East Lancashire Coach Builders for all subsequent new trolleybus bodies. These were mounted on a mix of AEC, Guy and Sunbeam chassis. For example, 19 to 22 were more Guy BTXs. Whilst wartime deliveries, 82 to 89 of 1942-3, were Sunbeam MS2s. Some trackless eventually carried up to three different fleet numbers. This Sunbeam MS2, a sister vehicle to the one now undergoing restoration, displays its 1947 number. During the war, the low-capacity single-deckers had hardly been sufficient as both Don Valley systems struggled to cope with the overwhelming demand. To provide cross-town facilities to the steelworks at Templeborough, trolleybus overhead was rapidly strung along the length of the entire tram route. This is the only known photograph of a trackless at Templeborough. Even the tram fleet was augmented by the acquisition of this veteran balcony car from Leeds, which was totally enclosed in 1948. Also supporting the single enders was one of the original, much renumbered and much rebuilt trams, which had been totally enclosed in 1942. The traction company had supplemented its fleet as early as 1937 with purchase of 6 ex-Notts and Derby single-deckers. Then, as loadings escalated to 15.5 million, half a dozen elderly guys came from Hastings in 1942. These were identical to these vehicles seen operating here in their hometown. Only 3 entered service in Mexborough, and these were soon ferrying miners to and from the local pits. The last one bowed out in July 1947. Followed by the last of the ex-Notts and Derby in 1950. Originally sporting a dull grey livery, 6 utility Sunbeam Ws with brush bodies joined the fleet in the spring of 1943. After the war, things were slow to improve. A chronic shortage of new vehicles forced Rotherham to send buses and trolleybuses for overhaul in this factory, which later became East Lancashire Bridlington Limited. This is one of the recently overhauled 1939 Guys. Renewal of the Mexborough fleet began in 1947 with delivery of 18 Sunbeam Ws, which were painted in the new green and cream, introduced in 1946. 12 Sunbeam F4s followed in 1948, with a final 3 in 1950. Known locally as garden sheds, they all had brush 32-seater bodies. On most, capacity was later increased to 35. They had cost £4,115 each. At least one garret made it into the new green, but their days were numbered, some having clocked up over 600,000 miles. Looking decidedly dingy, number 51 is in the old red-brown livery. The Raw Marsh staff had performed miracles, keeping the life-expired garrets on the road, but outsized loads had placed considerable strain on the wooden frame bodies. Several were sold off for use as caravans and chicken coops. Number 34 survived long enough to be rescued from a field near Moor End, Doncaster, and for over 25 years has resided at Santoff Trolleybus Museum. It fell to Rotherham 30 to have the most idyllic afterlife. The redundant Ransom literally floated into a new existence when its body was used to create an inspection vessel for the owners of the erstwhile South Yorkshire Navigation Company. However, for the corporation's single-ended trams, there was nothing. Nobody wanted them, despite being under 15 years old. The joint service with Sheffield had ceased in 1948, leaving the truncated Templeborough section to soldier on until the 13th of November 1949, when it is believed the surviving peak hour trackless workings also stopped. Their designer Sykes had died in 1943, and his successor Norman Rylance had been determined to be rid of the trams as swiftly as possible. Interestingly, right up until October 1960, the mile or so of track from Tinsley to Vulcan Road, which had once been owned by Rotherham, continued in use by Sheffield's trams. Note the Rotherham Crosley on the replacement bus route. Now this area has totally changed. Gone are the steel mills, replaced by the sprawling Meadow Hall complex. Since 1995, this has been served by Sheffield's new tram system. However, the long-promised route to Rotherham has yet to materialise. If and when it is finally opened, the wheel will indeed have come full circle. In the late 40s, Rotherham's trackless seemed secure enough, especially when the first of a long-awaited fleet of 44 Daimlers arrived in November 1949, the rest entering service by 1951. All had distinctive East Lancashire bodies, some being built at the firm's subsidiary factory in Bridlington. To the discerning, there were minor internal differences between the different bodies. These show number 9, one of the Bridlington products. These new arrivals slowly led to withdrawal of all the older single-deckers. Despite the 44 Daimlers, electric traction was facing an uncertain future. Rotherham did open this short extension up to Old Toll Bar in May 1948, but the Templeborough working ceased in 1949. And the lightly trafficked Greaseborough and Worry Goose Lane routes went over to buses. This is Greaseborough Terminus. En route into town at Munsborough Lane. Amazingly, the old toll bar extension lasted just over 5 years, the terminus reverting to Ewer's Road Loop in September 1953. This effectively killed off plans for an extension into Kimberworth Park Estate. Next, a few town centre views, including vehicles bound for Toll Bar. Across the country, the trolleybus was falling from favour. Buses seem more economical and flexible. Since nationalisation, many municipalities had lost their own supply of cheap electricity, and the cost of building a trolleybus extension had escalated to approximately £10,000 per mile. More damagingly, private car ownership was on the increase. The Rotherham system lost much of its character in May 1954, when the long-established interurban to Maltby was cut back to Wickersley. Furthermore, the replacing double-decker buses also served new housing estates. Turning at Maltby. Only 58 minutes was allowed for this 14-mile round trip, making it a really fast run. One of the reasons behind the closure was this bridge at Hellerby, which was too low for higher capacity double-decker trolleybuses. Improvements on the M&S included a new one-way system in the vicinity of Conisbrough Castle, introduced in 1948. Inbound journeys now followed a winding path through the steeply graded old village, whilst outbound vehicles followed the original wires. However, by the early 50s, the company was questioning its long-term commitment to electric traction. Plans for a half-mile extension from Addick Road had already been dropped, and soaring electricity prices had pushed up overall costs. Furthermore, the price for new overhead equipment was reputedly up by 20%. This led the new M&S manager, D.R. Vernon, to recommend replacement of the Green Lane loop in September 1954. Although used primarily by people heading to and from Rotherham, service was always provided by the company. Only the wiring to Kilnhurst Road loop was retained. The replacement buses were oil-engined Leyland Tiger Cubs with Wayman bodies. This design, which was adopted for the next 6 years, was instrumental in sealing the fate of the trackless. The six life-expired utilities were now sold to nearby Doncaster, who scrapped the bodies. They then overhauled the 26-foot-long chassis and fitted them with new 27-foot row bodies. Later, these would end up on second-hand bus chassis. The old utility bodies were then left to quietly disintegrate. Rebodying was much in vogue. Rotherham's new manager, I.O. Fisher, recommending the conversion of 14 of the CTE6s, the vehicles with English electric equipment. To this end, in June 1955, Doncaster 362 was hired to test the height of the Rotherham overhead, some sections subsequently being raised by up to 2 feet. The first of the rebodied single-deckers entered service in March 1956. When sufficient were available, the Crosstown, Kimberworth, Thryburgh and Silverwood routes went over to double-deckers on the 5th of May. Despite some reduction in frequency, and despite being duplicated by bus routes, the double-deckers transformed the previous loss into a profit, and for a brief period, the trackless were back in favour. The rebodying had certainly placed any short-term abandonment firmly on the back burner. However, there were worrying signs. Overall ridership on buses and trolleybuses fell by 4 million in the financial years 1958 and 59. As a result, receipts barely covered costs. Thoughts were now focusing on one-man operation. The big 70-seaters proved especially useful for peak hour and shift change duties. The bodies had cost £2,736 each. However, not one of them would clock up 10 years of service. During the rebodying programme, delicensed single-deckers were brought back into service to maintain the required fleet of 31 vehicles. The final six rebuilds took over the Wickersley and Breck services in February 1957, the double-deckers being allocated the new numbers 25 to 44. The eight single-deckers still required were renumbered 1 to 8, whilst the remainder were delicensed awaiting a buyer. Eventually, 17 would sail for sunnier climes in Spain. Some views now depicting Rotherham buses in the late 50s. One of Rylance's main objectives on being appointed manager had been to introduce high-capacity double-deckers, a process which started in 1946. Initial types included both Bristols and Crosleys, examples of which are seen here on steeply graded Doncaster Gate. When the last single-deckers were retired in 1968, this arguably broke the final link with the Sykes era. Back with the M&S. In January 1957, the local authorities served by the Trackless failed to exercise their legal right to purchase the company. Then in early 1958, strong objections followed the introduction of a 10-minute off-peak headway on the Trunk Mexborough Rotherham section. As a result, two Trackless, numbers 14 and 18, could be sold for rebodying in Doncaster. The end was in sight in July 1959, when the manager recommended abandonment owing to the poor condition of the vehicles and the infrastructure. There was only one objection, and the closure bill was approved on the 2nd of June 1960. 4 months later, the company announced the Trackless would be off the road by the following spring, to be replaced by high-capacity double-decker buses. In 7 years, things had really changed. Back in 1952, the 39 trolleybuses had carried 17 million passengers. By 1959, it was just 8 million, with only 19 vehicles. In contrast, the company's 6 buses had carried just 750,000 in 1952. By 1959, the 17 buses were carrying 6.75 million. The Trackless closure happened in two stages. First to go on New Year's Day, 1961, was the branch to Manvers Main, Woff. The colliery was so important, the name of the town was reduced to a mere parenthesis. En route was the lowest bridge on the system, with a headroom then of just 12 foot 9 inches, under which even single-deckers had to almost crawl on their hands and knees. Having covered the 1.25 miles from Manvers Main, the Seas then joined the throng of Trackless jostling through the centre of Mexborough. Just to keep visitors on their toes, the M&S used letters. A for Addick Road, B Conisborough Low, and C Conisborough High, whilst the Rotherham showed numbers. Latterly, most displayed 9 for either Addick Road or Conisborough Low. At the station hotel, the Seas diverged to climb up towards the picturesque narrow streets nestling beneath the ruins of Conisborough Castle, home of Athelstane, the fictional hero of Walter Scott's epic novel, Ivanhoe. This had been the outer limit of the original 1915 route, which had finished at the Dale. These scenes are on the one-way system introduced in 1948. This tranquil backwater, also served by buses since 1957, could not have been more different than the Manvers End, with its coking ovens, pit gear, shunting locos, smoke and pungent smells. The loop at Conisborough High was located at the end of Welfare Avenue. Here the Trackless served a large mining community of concentrated housing. Descending the new length of one-way wiring opened in 1948. down now to Conisbrough Low and the cramped terminus at Brook Square, sited within spitting distance of the main Doncaster Road. This was the junction from which the company had once entertained plans for a through service to Doncaster. Most drivers on the big 30-foot Rotherham Daimlers usually had to reverse in order to negotiate the tightly angled loop. The distance back to the junction with the high route was just over 1 mile. Journey time back to Frederick Street, 47 minutes. Cheap workman fares were available Monday to Friday before 8 a.m. and after 5 p.m., as well as between noon and 2 p.m. on Saturdays. It was also possible to buy a weekly book of 12 reduced price tickets. The 10.5 mile interurban connected several straggling but densely populated mining communities with Rotherham. In between were occasional country interludes. Overlooked by the castle, drivers squeezed round the loop before nipping smartly along Low Road to Burcroft, where the wires turned to follow the course of the River Don. In latter days, there were several dewirements on this section caused by drivers hitting the curves too quickly. The junction for the high and low branches was situated close to Conisbrough Station. For the next 2 miles, the trackless paralleled the railways and canals serving the nearby pits. One of the most photographed locations was the crossing of Denneby Main Colliery. The roadway was so skewed that occasionally vehicles could get their wheels jammed in the railway tracks. This place was a timekeeping headache. Delays, usually lasting from 3 to 10 minutes, kept lines of traffic waiting whilst a slow-moving freight puffed through on the main line from Doncaster to Sheffield. During one 14-hour period in 1961, these gates were shut 64 times, which led to renewed calls for a flyover. This has at last been approved 40 years later. In the vicinity of the various bridges spanning the Don and the Sheffield and South Yorkshire navigation, another favourite location was the sweeping curve close to the depot at Old Toll Bar. This had been the one-time limit of the old tram system and the starting point for the trackless feeder route to Conisbrough opened in 1915. Built to house both trams and trolleybuses, this was the final trackless wiring layout. The loop in green shows the original terminus of the 1915 route to the Dale. The building survives today as a tyre depot. Between Mexborough and Toll Bar, the original trackless had reached Bank Top by trailing a skate in the tram tracks. This was the junction for the run down to Addick Road. Opened in 1931, the branch had helped alleviate congestion in Mexborough, and it was from here that the company had entertained plans for an extension into a nearby estate. Journey time for the 7 mile run back to Rotherham, 35 minutes. Officially, Rotherham vehicles had once shown 8 for Addick Road, but latterly they tended to use either 8 or 9. weaving through Mexborough, where the population in 1960 was just under 19,000. For 13 years, miners from Manvers, Maine, had changed from trackless to tram here at Bank Top. The seas had come straight across, whilst the other route swept down the hill towards the bridge on Swinton Road. Next came the fascinating up and under at Swinton South Station on the Midland Main Line. Here enthusiasts could watch the trackers storm the humpback bridge over the Dern and Dove branch of the Sheffield and Yorkshire Navigation before swooping smartly down under the railway bridge with its clearance of 13 foot 9 inches. Unusually, this small bridge was maintained and painted not by the Waterway Authority, but by the Traction Company. Dating from the cutting of the canal, it had been rebuilt in 1839 and again in 1906 to cope with the weight of the trams. The dart over the canal and the dive and dip under the railway had all the thrills of a roller coaster ride. Views now on Church Street, Swinton. The combined population of Swinton and Kilnhurst in 1960 was just under 13,000. A totally new wiring layout was opened here as late as February 1961, when this roundabout was built at the Woodman Inn, Swinton. This had been the site of the one-time tramway junction between the Dernan district and the M&S. Next came the sprint along Warren Vale. Opened in 1932, this had replaced the steeply graded hill formerly used by the trams and trolleybuses. Being relatively free of stops, drivers could really show their paces. Breaking free from the congested streets of Swinton and Mexborough, the trackless purred along the well-made road at speeds in excess of 35 miles an hour. Here was another area of total contrast. Gone was all trace of industrial grime and gloom, replaced by fields and fauna, giving this stretch of the interurban a truly rural feeling. Problems at the junction leading up to the loop on Kilnhurst Road. The loop was used by M&S vehicles working back to the depot from the Rotherham direction. They had to do this owing to the absence of access wiring into Dale Road Depot from the south. In its final form, all trackless entered from the north, then ran round ready to depart in either direction. Originally built for trams, the depot is now used by Yorkshire Traction, who eventually absorbed the M&S. Scenes now in the old part of Rawmarsh. The M&S Tower Wagon. turning into Stocks Lane. Ascending Raw Marsh Hill. In the early 60s, the population of Raw Marsh and Park Gate was just under 20,000, but growing fast. Approaching the centre of Rotherham, the trackless first passed the Corporation's depot on Raw Marsh Road. This was huddled on land between the River Don and the Sheffield and Yorkshire Navigation. This was the final wiring layout for the joint routes. After March 1961, the two-way wiring along Effingham Street remained in use until 1965, giving access to Rotherham Depot. Inbound, passing the depot. Outbound vehicles, including one of the M&S's new Wayman-bodied Leyland Atlanteans, crosses Grafton Bridge, followed by a Corporation trolley bus heading into the depot. These were the wires which survived until 1965. Examples of both bus types which ousted the company trackless between 1954 and 1961. Much of this area is now semi-derelict. The inbound wires took the trackless through older neighbourhoods close to the canal. This sharp right-angle bend led onto Chantry Bridge. From here, the single set of wires led to the loading point on Frederick Street. As there was no Sunday service on the Conanby branch, only Addick Road and Conisborough Low were operational on the final day of normal service, Sunday the 26th of March 1961. The last ever enthusiast tour over the M&S was organised by the Doncaster Omnibus and Light Rail Society, participants boarding outside the Corporation Transport offices on Frederick Street. Rotherham 3 would have the dubious distinction of being the last vehicle on certain sections of wiring. For example, the little U's round the houses loop at Park Gate. The undoubted highlight was taking the 30-footer onto the Conanby section. One concerned local even warned the driver they'll never get a blue one up there. The six-wheeler did make it successfully in both directions, and so a Rotherham vehicle became the last ever trackless to sweep cautiously around the castle. The last M&S trackless had worked up to Conanby the night before. However, since January, there have been fewer and fewer trolleybuses running up to Conisborough High. Number 3 had originally been number 6 before being renumbered in 1957. When eventually sold for scrap in July 1963, it fetched just £66. After a mix of determined curb scraping, elbow grease and reversing, the driver finally made it round the loop at Conisborough High. By the end, only a dozen or so Company F4s were still active, all the Sunbeam Ws having been withdrawn the previous couple of years. Today, this site has totally changed. Gone are the footbridge, the high signal box, the headgear, and all the associated buildings, swept aside as the coal industry crumbled away. The six remaining Rotherham single-deckers were now de-licensed, but at least one was subsequently photographed at Kimberworth in 1962, probably specially re-licensed for another enthusiast tour. Some old-style tickets, once issued on the joint services. For the last day, special tickets were issued from the usual set-right machines. Locally, there was virtually no interest in the demise of the trackless, only a handful of enthusiasts boarding the final regular service vehicle, the 11:08 p.m. from Brook Square to the depot. However, the traction company did publish an attractive souvenir brochure. And there was also a smaller combined souvenir and timetable on sale for sixpence. The end came on a bleak Monday, the 27th, when number 29 headed a procession of four vehicles. On leaving Rawmarsh, 29 ran through to Conisbrough Low, to precede a new Atlantean carrying dignitaries from London, whilst 32, 33 and 36 waited for the guests at Old Toll Bar. These were referred to as cars 5, 6 and 7 in the official arrangements for the day. From Toll Bar, the guests would travel in the three trackless to Rotherham for a civic reception. Number 29, referred to as Car 4, had officially been converted into a partial open topper. Occupying the open rear section was the Rawmarsh Prize Band, which blew lustily as the procession wended its way through the mainly deserted streets. 40 years ago, no one was really bothered about a few old trolleybuses. Also, the company had decided on a low-key event. Despite this, 29 had been scrubbed and polished, and even a few flags fluttered from its trolley poles, whilst red, white and blue buntings circled the bodywork. The other three participants had not even been washed. March the 27th, 1961, marked the end of company-owned trolleybuses in the UK and the end of those operated by a British Electric Traction subsidiary. Also, there would now be no more single-decker trolleybuses in England. Of the M&S survivors, two went to Teesside ostensibly for rebodying as double-deckers, but in fact they were cannibalised for spares. However, of the 12 sold to Bradford, where the management had become most adept at snapping up vehicles at bargain prices, seven were transformed into double-deckers. As the F4's chassis were not lengthened, they were fitted with 28-foot, 6-inch long, 66-seater East Lancashire front-loading bodies. Interestingly, as far back as 1955, the M&S had offered to sell all their trackless to Bradford at £500 each. By waiting just 6 years, 12 chassis plus new spares were acquired for just £124 each. Most of the batch lasted until the final demise of the Bradford system in March 1972. As the great network came to an end, it would be a Mexborough that made the last schedule run, and another Mexborough that made the final valedictory trip. Exactly 11 years to the day after the F4s, then in their single deck form, had operated their final trips on their home patch. The 44 Rotherham single-deckers have a complex history. Some were delicensed as early as 1954. 20 received new double-deck bodies. 15 were sold to Spain for £1,133 each and dispatched between April and July 1960. Then in December, two more followed, culled from the 8 vehicles kept for the joint Mexborough routes. The remainder, numbers 3 to 8, were sold for scrap during 1962-3. Retrospectively, it seems that the East Lancashire bodies had suffered some undue wear and tear, probably due to the three-axle chassis and the presence of only one bulkhead. Those sold to Spain remain much as they were, taking their distinctive East Lancashire contours to San Sebastian and Cadiz. However, they were altered to accommodate the switch from left to right-hand running. New numbers 1 and 2 went to an interurban line linking San Sebastian to Tolosa. Here they were given the numbers 8 and 9. In 1965, both were off the road, but 11 years later, number 9 was rescued for preservation in Spain. The 15 dispatched between April and July 1960 all went to Cadiz. These have been rebuilt with dual doors and given the numbers 11 to 25. Initially, they provided an express service paralleling an existing tram route. In the mid-60s, they were again rebuilt, and in this guise outlived the rebodied Mexborough F4s in Bradford. Further footage of English trolleybuses in Spain, including London Transport's post-war six-wheelers, can be found in our highly acclaimed video, Q1s in Spain. Details at the end of this tape. In the UK, trolleybus systems were tumbling like ninepins. Rotherham converted the 3 to Wickersley, plus the short-working 4 to Brex Crescent in January 1963. This spelt the end for the inner section of the former Maltby Interurban. Here a 4 arrives and turns at Brex Crescent, with the wires to Wickersley stretching into the distance. This closure would also release the first of the double-deckers for scrap. Now just three routes remained. The Crosstown 6 from Kimberworth to Thriber, the short working 5 from town to pumping station, and the 49 from town to Silverwood Colliery. All three routes ran 7 days a week. With the 49 primarily catering for shift changes at the colliery. Kimberworth Loop was some 2 miles to the west of the centre at Ewers Road. From 1948 to 53, the wires had extended a further half mile up to the toll bar. Headways during the day varied from every 7 minutes to every 15. The route followed the old Kimberworth tram line, serving a mainly older residential area. The run into town involved crossing three bridges, including two local rail lines. These span the former Midland Line close to the site of Masborough Station and the old Great Central route in and out of Rotherham Central. From town, the sixes were joined by the fives and 49s, which terminated by looping through town. Corporation Street, with the tower wagon, effecting necessary repairs. Outbound, all three routes pass the M&S loading point in Frederick Street. The trunk artery from Effingham Square to the junction at Mowbray Street enjoyed a very heavy service, with a 2-minute headway in peak hours. Rotherham had always had a reputation for fast running. In 1939, it boasted the fastest trolleybus schedules in the whole country, a position post-war crews were determined to maintain, as demonstrated by these views on Fitzwilliam Road. At the Mowbray Street roundabout, the fives turn south along the short spur to Pumping Station Terminus. At the terminus. Having navigated the intricate wiring layout at the junction, note the feeder wiring on the right, the 6s and 49s continued following the course of the old Thriber tram route up this hilly part of Doncaster Road. This was the point at which the trackless diverged from the former tram route to travel along Oldgate Lane. This had been done so that both the replacing Thriber trackless, as well as those heading along the extension to Silverwood Colliery, could use the same wires as far as the junction of Park Lane and Hollings Lane. Preparing to cross the narrow bridge over the now disused line serving Silverwood Sidings. The sixes ran north along Park Lane to terminate within a few hundred yards of the main Rotherham Doncaster Road. Unlike the trams, the trackless did not serve the old village of Triber, but their passengers came from the new council housing developed in the 20s and 30s. It was from this terminus that Rotherham had plans for crossing the moors in order to link up with the Doncaster system. Like so many similar schemes, it never materialised. The mile-long branch to Silverwood was truly sylvan in nature. After working underground, the miners could enjoy a brief country run before hitting the heavily built-up areas surrounding the town centre. Heading for the colliery, an outbound 49 negotiates the tightly angled S Bend, which preceded an attractive graded section flanked by woods and fields. Timings on the 49 were very much dictated by colliery shift changes. Even though the first journey left town on Mondays to Saturdays at 3:50 a.m, there were often lengthy gaps in the service, and photographers could spend time, often in poor weather, waiting to film these elusive workings. Silverwood Terminus. Despite over 50 years of service, there was to be virtually no ceremony to mark the end of Rotherham's trolleybuses. The manager had, at the end of his annual report, stated, "The abandonment is a major change in operation, and reluctant as one is to see these grand vehicles disappear from our streets, it was no longer economical to retain them." The end came on the Saturday, the 2nd of October, 1965. Few people even realizing the trolleybuses were coming to the end of the line. Close-up views of the new wiring installed following the redesign of the road layout at Effingham Square in 1962. One of the last workings prepares to leave Silverwood. Two vehicles negotiate the wiring at Pumping Station Terminus. At Kimberworth, circle lights were actuated at night for ease of visibility. On Sunday the 3rd, the National Trolleybus Association and the Nottingham Trolleybus Society both ran last day tours, each society also being presented with one of the redundant Daimlers. Cynics claiming this was to relieve Rotherham of keeping any representative vehicles themselves. The Nottingham Group inherited 37, formerly single-decker 17, and the NTA 44, formerly single-decker 18. Although Rotherham's trackless had come to an end, 44 would soon be making guest appearances under foreign wires. Here it has crossed the Pennines to participate in the celebration surrounding the closure of the Manchester and Ashton systems in December 1966. Under Wolverhampton wires before that system too bowed out in March 1967. Wolverhampton had enjoyed a long association with the trolleybus. It had been a true trolleybus stronghold, as well as a major manufacturing base for the industry. For example, all Rotherham's Guys and Sunbeam trolleybuses had been built in the town. Both 44 and the other preserved double-decker 37 are currently located at the Santoff Trolley Museum. Today, there are still a few potent reminders of the bygone days of the trackless. The very low bridge at Manvers Main is still in situ. This was where the M&S trackless had crawled underneath on their hands and knees. Also totally recognisable is the delightful up and under at Swinton. Here the wires had latterly been shared by the M&S four-wheelers and Rotherham's bigger six-wheelers. The 1915 depot structure at Old Toll Bar remains in use as a tyre outlet. It was from here that the final M&S procession departed for Rotherham 40 years ago on the 27th of March 1961. The M&S procession eventually returned to the main depot. From Dale Road, a few of the trackless departed for new lives in Doncaster and Bradford. Today the building is still in use by Yorkshire Traction. Besides the two preserved Rotherham double-deckers, there is also the Mexborough Garrett in a poor state of repair and a wartime Rotherham Sunbeam MS2. This vehicle, number 74, is now undergoing restoration, and some of the profit from the sale of this video will go towards completing the work. One day it should be possible to ride on the MS2. And maybe even the Garrett will once again raise its poles. After all, miracles do happen.